Okay. Thanks, organizers, for the invitation. I feel great honor to give a talk here. And as we all know, photoric space is a cohomology ring and a stable complex structure, and it's very clear. And it also admits group action and contains mining combinatoric information. So they often serve as some examples for other aspects in topology, such as index theorem, Bodhidharma theorem, and maybe geometry topology. So in this talk, I will give a concept theory on positive scalar curvature manifold. Then I do some simple calculation on Kolmogorov manifold and its submanifolds. First, I will give quickly scan the definition of curvature. First, for Riemann manifold M, G is the Riemann metric, R be the curvature tensor. Now, for any two tangent vector x, y in a tangent space, we can about it. So, this one.
Opposite.
Oh, sorry.
This goes to.
Oh, thanks. Thank you. We can define sectional curvature using this formula. Then we can define the rich curvature. For two fixed tangent vector in the tangent space, and this map induces a linear transformation T. The trace of T is called rich tensor S of the Riemann manifold. Then SXX is called the rich curvature along tangent vector X at point P. This is the rich curvature. Then going on, we can use the rich tensor S that induce another linear transformation, which says for this equation. And the trace of R star is called the scalar curvature rho of the Riemann manifold. Sorry. So, if we choose the local orthonormal tangent frame E1 dot EN at point P, then rich curvature is the sum of sectional curvature, and the scalar curvature rho equal to the sum of the rich curvature. So this implies that rich curvature is the average of sectional curvature, and the scalar curvature is the average of rich curvature. So in Riemann geometry, the study on the relation between curvature and its global structure is an important topic. The existence of positive scalar curvature may be the weakest assumption and is closely related to topology property of that manifold. So next I will give a quick survey on positive scalar curvature manifold. Hitchin may first get this theorem for compact spin manifold. If it has a metric of positive scalar curvature, then its alpha invariant must be vanished. For this alpha invariant, I will explain it detailedly later. And we will ask this question. Which manifold admits a positive scalar curvature metric? The study mainly due on Sean Yao and Gromov Lawson. They proved independently that if M is a manifold which carries a metric of positive scalar curvature, then any manifold obtained from M by a co-dimension 3, greater than equal 3 surgery then it also carries the metric of positive scalar curvature. And next, being the same paper. No, no, we didn't assume it to be simply connected. Yeah. And next, sorry.
Talking about the subject.
Yes. Yes, the assumption is different. Later, Gromov and Lawson prove that if M is simply connected dimension greater than equal than 5, if it is not spin, so it must carry the metric of positive scalar curvature. And for the spin case, and we have an equivalent condition. It's proved by Gromov, Lawson, and Stotz. Now we can state it. If M is a simply connected closed spin manifold of dimension greater and equal than 5, then M carries the metric of positive scalar curvature if and only if alpha invert is equal to 0. So we can see that the alpha invert is very important on the study of positive scalar curvature. And I will use this theorem very frequently later. Next, I will introduce the definition of alpha invariant. I cannot tell all the details. Alpha invariant is RTR minimal single invariant from the spin Boltzmann to KO coefficient ring. So first, Hitchin first studied the relation between positive scalar curvature. He constructed a family of Fredholm operators, which is very closely related to Dirac operator. And its index is just the KO characteristic number alpha. For the calculation of alpha inversion is very complicated. Next, I will list all the known results. If the dimension is the multiple of 4, then alpha invariant equal to a hat genus up to a multiple. So it's very somehow very easy to compute, I think. Next, for other dimension, much more difficult. Here I will give a construction by Zhang Weiping. I will use this construction very frequently, so I will slow down. First, we have a spin C manifold, which dimension is 8k plus 4. Then, there exists a complex sum bundle whose first term class equal to the second stiffer written class of k mod 2. This is from the definition of spin C manifold. Then we choose some manifold B, which is Pongari dual to C1. Now, then B must be a spin manifold. So Weiping Zhang proved the Rochlin type congruence formula like this. This must be an integer first. It can be regarded as a twisted A hat genus over B. So it must be an integer. Now I will present a theorem by Wim Miller. It states that every causally toric manifold of dimension greater than 0 admits a Tn invariant metric of positive scalar curvature. This is a very nice result. And the proof is divided into three parts. First, when n equal to 1 is very obviously. When n equal to 2, every four-dimensional coated torque manifold admits an invariant metric of positive rich curvature, that's the positive scalar curvature. When n greater than equal than 3, and he used equivalent surgery, and he proved that every moment angle manifold admits invariant metric of positive scalar curvature. Then we can get m by coefficient Tn. This is by the Barrett and Bergeris result. And for the proof of third part, I want to use the calculation of alpha invariant to give the another proof, but I will not prove the invariant. First, we know that every coated torque manifold is simply connected, so we can use the Stokes theorem. If it's not spin, if M is not spin, M is a coated torque manifold. If it's not spin, so it admits a metric of positive scalar curvature. It's Gromov and Lawson's work. And if it's spin, we can separate it by the dimension of it. If the dimension 2n is a multiple of 4, the A hat genus alpha invariant equal to the A hat genus equal to 0, since M admits a non-trivial circle action, and by Atias result, it must be 0. And when 2n equal to 6, modular mod 6, alpha must be 0 because the Q group is 0. When 2n equal to 2 and mod 8, and we can regard it, M as a characteristic submanifold of M times CP1. And corresponding to the generator, we know very exactly generator T of CP1. So I can use Jung's formula, alpha M equal to this product, and can be read down as the product of two connect pair. For the first pair, it's just the A hat genus of M. It must be 0. So that's the result is 0. So in conclusion, and if M is a spin, the alpha M must be 0. So it admits a metric of positive scalar curvature. So the whole proof is finished. As we know that all coated torque manifolds admits positive scalar curvature. So we want to find the manifold which doesn't admit positive scalar curvature. I mainly rely on Jung's construction. So we will recall its construction like this. And we also, if we want to apply Stone's theorem, we must assume M is simply connected. And this can be done by Kito and Matsumoto's work. And if K is a coated torque manifold, he is spin. It is simple connected. And if dimension is greater than equal than 6, that's the submanifold B. By the second atom, it is also simply connected. So we can do the process for 8K plus 1 dimensional coated torque manifold K. K is greater than 0. And since K admits a stable complex structure, so it's a spin-free manifold. So we can assume it's a cohomology ring, like a polynomial ring, modular 2 ideal. And it's a stable complex structure can be read like this. We are all familiar with it. And we choose a degree 2 cohomology class U and U can be read as a linear combination of VI. So we can choose appropriate D, such as U equal to W2, mod 2. So we can get this proposition. Let B be the simply connected spin submanifold Poincaré dual to U, then alpha invert can be read like this. So if equal to zero, we can immediately know that it admits a positive scalar curvature. If it equal to one, it doesn't admit a positive scalar curvature. And we know that the calculation of this may be very complicated. I think because the variable VI are not independent. They have relation by I and two ideas, J and I. The complexity of the idea is the difficulty to do this calculation. So first we do some easy calculation with very few relation here. First, this is John's work. He first computed the hypersurface of complex project space. And for arbitrary positive integer D, and we denote VD be the D degree regular hypersurface. And by the result from algebraic geometry, it's simply connected. Then, if D is odd, VD is a simply connected spin submanifold Poincaré dual to D. Then alpha VD equal to B can be represented as a binomial coefficient. How to determine if this binomial coefficient is even or odd? We can use the Laplace theorem in number theory. I will give some example. For 4K plus two dimensional project, complex projective space, if D is even, no, VD is non-spin, so it admits a positive scalar curvature. And for CP2, but CP6, V7, V9, we can calculate that their alpha invert equal to 1. And they doesn't admit positive scalar curvature matrix. And V11, V13 admits positive scalar curvature. And we can tear all their hypersurface whether they admit a positive scalar curvature or not. And then we can consider the product of complex projective space. So we can choose a degree two common class U, and we can know that if DI plus TI is odd for any I run from 0 to S. Then we can choose B to be the simply connected spin submanifold Poincaré dual to U. Then alpha B can be read as the product of this chronic pair, because the reason is that these XI are independent. They didn't have relation. So we can write them in the product form. And we denote AI to be one of the factor, like this. And by the residue theorem, we can use knowledge in complex analysis to calculate it. So we have this proposition, AI equal to also a binomial coefficient regardless DI is odd or even, we can all get this result. So let B be a simply connected spin submanifold defined above. B doesn't admit a positive scalar curvature metric if and only if all AI is odd. It's very simple because they are product. Now I will give some example. For CP1 times CP5, if DI equal to 2 or 6, D2 equal to 6 or 7 and so on, B doesn't admit a positive scalar curvature. And for CP2 times CP4, if DI equal to 3, 4 and so on, D2 equal to 5, 7, then B doesn't admit a positive scalar curvature metric. For any product of projective space, we can all get this result. We can extend to a more complicated case, but I didn't get a final result. I will assume my...
I'm going
to ask. Yes. 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 We are all familiar with the definition of generalized Bott manifold. I will skip it. Now I will show its proper structure. Let PK be the projectivization of a sum of JK complex Lamb bundle written sum with the trivial Lamb bundle over BK, and the eta be the tautological Lamb bundle over BK. Yeah, and VI be the first chain class of eta. Then we have a stable complex structure on the tangent bundle. The first segment is a pullback of tangent bundle of BK minus 1. The second segment is the written sum with the bundle along the fiber and written sum with a trivial Lamb bundle. And the cohomology ring is an algebra the cohomology ring of BK minus 1 with the variable V, modular idea. This relation comes from that JK's chain class vanish. So we can get this relation. So we first consider the Bott total of hat 2. We assume J1 plus J2 equal to 2 mod the 6. We can denote the BI T be the chain roots for the complex bundle. We can choose do the same process, choose the degree 2 cohomology class. It can be represented as DI T plus D2, D1 T plus D2 V. And if D2 plus J2 is odd, and J1 plus D1 and plus the first chain class is odd. And we can choose B to be the simply connected spin submanifold Poincaré dual to U. And its alpha invariant can be present like this. But here, this V plus BIT is the chain roots for tangent bundle of B2. For this bundle. So the work is just to find out the maybe J1 plus J2 degree terms in this polynomial. it seems to be complicated because we have this relation, we can get rid, cannot get rid of this influence. So we can write alpha b as the form, as a sum of ak times bk. Ak denotes the coefficient of this one in the polynomial. And bk denotes the Kronecker product of this element to the fundamental homology class of B2. I can write down the presentation of BK, like this summation. But for the AK, I do not have any idea to do this calculation. AK means the coefficient of this in this polynomial. If we try to use the residues theorem and the very complicated calculation, I don't know if there is an easy another view to do this operation. I think this calculation is common in many index theorem and index theorem for Cotes-Tolle manifold. If we solve this problem, we can apply them to other, such as Ahad genus, maybe Witten genus, and so on.
If you know the first few values of AK, you could put it into the sequence finder, online sequence finder, and we'll find this. It's not a joke. If you know the first few, the first few terms, AK, you can put it into the sequence finder.
That's what Sriram
did.
Oh, if anyone has idea, please teach me. Yeah. And this is my reference. That's all. Thanks.